Yeah, just check us out at careers@busairn.ie for our current recruitment campaign, and dublinbus.ie as well. As I said to you, we're live till the 19th of April. Yeah, sure, look, we'll spread the word about apprenticeship. If you know of anyone who wants to be a mechanic, we're recruiting for apprentice heavy vehicle mechanics, so yeah, it's a great time for me to come in and chat to you. And what we were basically looking for you to do is go on to our careers page at Bus Éireann, careers@busairn.ie. You apply there, there's an application process there with a couple of killer questions in it.
Okay.
You know, I think everybody knows at this stage the killer questions are key. You know, a few mandatory ones there, I'm not going to say what they are. This year we're looking for 47 apprentices nationwide. Majority are in Dublin, pre-employment medical, and we test your fitness, drugs and alcohol tests as well, because the safety critical role that you're coming into with public transport.
This week we discuss heavy vehicle mechanic apprenticeships with David, the Apprenticeship Programme Manager for Bus Éireann and Dublin Bus, and Ahmed, a recently qualified heavy vehicle mechanic for Bus Éireann. This episode was brought to you by Top Drawer Talent, the Supply Chain Procurement Recruitment Specialist. Let's get into it. Here we go.
So today I'm joined by David and Ahmed from Bus Éireann, and David, you're originally from Dublin Bus.
Originally from Dublin Bus, yeah, David Poynton Rowley, Apprenticeship Manager for Bus Éireann and Dublin Bus Connor. So thanks, Mick, for having us on today.
So look, Bus Éireann, right, and Dublin Bus, the apprenticeship programme is blended. You look after both, as far as I know. How many apprenticeships are you guys offering at the moment? Is it just the apprenticeship for mechanics, or is it other apprenticeships?
Yeah, so I suppose just to give you a little bit of a whistle-stop tour on the history of it, the CIE group in general had apprenticeships within the company for trains and buses since the 1960s, and that was always the case. They were trained up in Inchicore on apprenticeship, mainly on the vehicles of heavy vehicle mechanic, okay? And through the 80s, 90s, the same thing, the apprentices would come in and do a four-year apprenticeship and mainly be in the apprentice training centre in Inchicore. So around 2002, a decision was made, in 87, the three companies split, right? So they went into Dublin Bus, Bus Éireann and Irish Rail, 1987, but apprenticeship continued to be held up in Inchicore for the three companies. And 2002, it was decided that then the Irish Rail side of the house wanted to just hold off an apprenticeship, but Bus Éireann, Dublin Bus decided, well, we still need our heavy vehicle mechanic apprenticeship to run. Hence, it moved across then to Bus Éireann. So Bus Éireann basically oversee and manage the recruitment of heavy vehicle mechanics for the two. Now, that being said, my role, basically, I sit in the middle of the two as such. My holding company is Bus Éireann, but I work for the two in recruitment and assessment of apprentices between the two companies, and an advisory basis, I suppose, for both. Perfect. Like, you know, and it's great because, like, I came through this apprenticeship myself. And 21 years ago, actually the first group as such from the split, as a heavy vehicle mechanic apprentice, and I end up in Dublin Bus side of the house.
Right.
Applied for Bus Éireann, but I end up in Dublin Bus because my address is Mead, on the border as such, commuter belt, and was lucky enough then to get placed in the Summerhill garage in off Mountjoy Square there with Dublin Bus.
Okay.
And I suppose the rest is history. But I suppose a funny one for you, just to touch on it. I'm now obviously manager of the programme, but the lady that I work closely alongside in the apprenticeship programme, Suzanne McGilloway, she's a senior HR consultant in Bus Éireann. She actually recruited me. And now I work alongside her in the same
So there's that progression avenue for you.
Yeah, it's great.
Look, right, let's say someone wants an apprenticeship. I suppose, what are you guys looking for on the CV if they want to be like the HGV mechanic?
Look, I suppose let's take into account that most our applicants are mostly school leavers that are probably in the middle of their leaving cert.
Okay.
So the CV won't be bursting with experience, right? But the one that would always kind of trigger points for me when I'm looking through an application or a CV would be interest and hobbies. What are they into? Are they into hands-on stuff, you know, sports, activities? A lot of them might have motorsport, GAA or soccer or rugby. You kind of twig on that because there's teamwork section in that, like, you know, it's a competency-based interview. You want to see what they're about and how they can adjust in the environment that they're in. I know you're involved in recruitment, Connor, so you know straight away when you meet somebody within the first 2 minutes, if they have a spark and they have a genuine interest, it'll come through pretty quick. It's the attitude, it's what they're about, and you'll see bits of that on the CV and you'll try and pull from that, you know, and see what you can get. But the majority are young people coming through, so you want to try and kind of catch something that might just stand out in that CV. It might be something about F1, you know, interest in F1, it might draw on that. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
And look, if someone's interested in getting a job or obtaining a job at Bus Éireann or Dublin Bus, what are the educational requirements for an apprenticeship program with you guys?
So, predominantly in years gone by, we used to go off the standard of junior cert 5 subjects, category D or higher, okay? Okay. Mathematics being one that you'd have to have, or leaving cert. Or leaving cert as well, okay. We have since moved away from that. The reason being is we felt that we were missing a cohort of people that, you know, whether they've come in from another country and mightn't have the junior cert or leaving cert or mightn't done an equivalency, and the equivalency is not the same. We said, right, okay, we're missing out on these people.
Yeah.
Let's see what we can do. We could have early school leavers as well. We had to do a full review on it because numbers dropped off a few years ago. And we wanted to make sure we captured everybody. So now we operate to the soloist equivalency. So that basically means junior cert and leaving cert is still there. It's the standard, but you also have leaving cert applied. You have you basically have level 3, level 4, level 5 PSE courses or whatever maybe in an ETB that you might do.
Yeah.
The equivalency of what it would match as a junior cert or leaving cert. Okay. So there's a few different avenues with the soloist equivalency now, which is brought back in people from disadvantaged areas and backgrounds that maybe they've come in from a different country and they might have done another course in ETB that met a level 4 or level 5.
Okay.
So it's great. It's opened up the doors for us.
That's brilliant. Yeah, because some apprenticeship programs are different, right? Some require a leaving cert, some don't. Whereas I suppose the minimum requirement if, let's say, someone from Ireland was looking to apply would be junior cert.
Yeah.
Good junior cert.
Good junior cert. Like, you know, the thing, technology's moving. We definitely are seeing, you know, obviously electric vehicles, EV, alternative fuel vehicles coming on stream, they're here, and we have to move that. So the level of maths is going to increase, so we have to be conscious of that. But like everything, there's training aids there and there's a study support scheme in place where we can help apprentices move on in areas that they might be weak in.
Okay.
But yeah, like look, entry, like we have had many career guidance teachers coming up to us, you know, talk to us in years gone by before we changed this. You know, I have a student that is not great in this area and they're on leaving cert applied. You know, can they get an apprenticeship with you? And we're like, well, what's their junior cert like? You know, and then if they didn't meet the standard, they were kind of nearly stuck. You know, so the avenues were kind of few and far between for them. So now we've moved and now we're able to have those conversations with the teachers and they're like, great, happy days, great. You know.
Yeah.
Now, not all employers, as you mentioned, some of our other semi-state bodies aren't moving that way.
Yeah.
But it will happen, I'd say. It will happen, yeah.
Yeah, brilliant. Okay, and then let's say, right, someone meets the education requirements, the CV is okay. What's the interview process like then for obtaining the job? So I know you mentioned competency-based. How many rounds are they going?
Yeah, so I suppose we'll notch it back a little bit on that one. We'll go back to say, currently now we're recruiting for apprentice heavy vehicle mechanics, so it's a great time for me to come in and chat to you. And what we were basically looking for you to do is go onto our careers page at Bus Éireann, careers at busairn.ie. You apply there. There's an application process there with a couple of killer questions in it.
Okay.
You know, I think everybody knows at this stage the killer questions are key. You know, a few mandatory ones there. I'm not going to say what they are.
That kind of
filters down straight away what type of person you are and whether you're going to fit in.
Yeah.
You know, it's simple. So that goes in. You go in there and you apply and you upload your education criteria. And then what happens is then you'll get called for an aptitude test.
Okay.
Aptitude test is standard for a lot of us that are in the engineering side of the house, okay? And it's very important for us to try and filter fairly and score accordingly, okay?
Okay.
You will be called for that. You'll have 5 days to complete it on the time that you get called for it.
Okay.
And there's 3 or 4 areas that we test in, numeracy, spatial awareness, and mechanical reasoning. You know, there's various things there in that. Now, I would say to anybody that's looking to get into it, there's so many options online to Google these aptitude tests, and they're pretty much very similar. And if you apply for one of us, say in this area, that aptitude test will cover a lot of employers in engineering functions anyway.
Okay.
A craft trades, I suppose. And then once, if you're successful in that, then what we do, Connor, is we score our top 100 or top 200. So say this year we're looking for 47 apprentices nationwide. Majority are in Dublin. The biggest body of that is, I think there's roughly nearly 30 apprentices, I think 27 or 28 apprentices for Dublin alone.
Okay.
So we'll try and score the top 50, pull them in for interview,
okay,
or top 100, depending on what way we want to. Maybe if we want to interview 6-1 or 8-1, We decide with our HR teams what we're going to do around that.
Okay.
And we'll interview, call in for competency-based interview.
Yeah.
Teamwork, safety is number one.
Okay.
Safety, teamwork, you know, all five competency-based areas, you're scored on that. And the plan would be then half-hour slot there. If you're in the mix, and we maybe pull two or three people from that interview process, we'll call you then for a practical assessment. This is a new piece I was saying to Ahmed earlier on. Ahmed missed all this. He was lucky enough back 4 years ago. But now we're doing a little bit of a practical piece where we call you in and we actually see, okay, we liked you to interview. You've done well. Let's see how it translates to one or two little assessments. And they're very entry-level stuff. It could be just basically reading an instruction and putting into practice, because we want to see you process that into reality, you know, into hands-on.
Okay.
It's a new piece we've done. We tried it last year with a company there that basically came in and said, look, maybe this avenue you go to get people that are actually good at their hands, who might not interview as well, but they're really good at their hands. So if we see that, okay, there's potential here with this person on the CV, but didn't get a great chance in chatting at the interview, they're kind of choked up,
nervous, whatever.
Well, let's get them out onto the floor.
Okay.
You know? Yeah.
It's a really good way, you know, because some people, I suppose, skill leavers especially, probably like their first job that they're applying for, and first interview, first real interview that they've ever gone to. So that's a good way of doing things. I know, like, we had like Dylan Bradshaw, and they just bring people in for a trial run in the salon, like sweep the floors, fold the nails or whatever, get the stuff, whatever they need. So that's another good way of doing it. So it's more of a practical side of things. Grant, after the practical side of things, then are you back in for another interview, or is there a job?
Interviews are done, thank God. So people are delighted with that. But then it's a pre-employment medical. It's standard, really, I suppose, for a lot of companies like ourselves. Pre-employment medical, and we test your fitness, drugs and alcohol tests as well, because the safety critical role that you're coming into with public transport. Okay. And then the plan would be then, Connor, each year then, once we have that process kind of boxed off throughout the summer, you'll start then with the academic year of August, September. That'll be the aim, to try and line up everybody, especially with school leavers. Now, and we have mature students like Ahmed here that came through to us a few years ago. Like, we try and line up with academic year, with college placements, the whole lot, just to keep it flowing nicely. Unfortunately, over the last few years, obviously, there's a backlog there with the training, but that's neither here nor there. We keep our system going the same way.
You came in from the PLC side of things, right?
I started off in the PLC pre-apprenticeship, just to see where it might lead me to.
Yeah.
And that's actually when I met David, came in to do an open presentation.
Okay.
Introducing the apprenticeship for Bus Éireann Dublin Bus. And I said, that's for me. Whatever he was saying, I was like, I need to, and the guy that was actually my tutor back then, he says, that's where you will learn everything.
Okay.
You know? Really? You get the best training, the first hazard, as David was saying. Your safety awareness is your number one. There's no point coming in with 10 fingers and going home at 9. You might as well just leave it.
You're a little bit like myself.
So it's safety, and it's always on a Friday. You know, you're trying to rush home, you know, when I go, don't. That 5 minutes could be, you know, could turn vital. But yeah, I started my apprenticeship in
2019.
Qualified in 2023, say September-ish is my finalized, but December I was sighted off. January I was in the job and as a qualified mechanic.
Did you have an interest in becoming a mechanic before you went and done the PLC, or what was the background?
Yes,
there?
I did. Okay. I was out driving HGV vehicles, from tow trucks to rigids, Arctics, and I knew about air brakes and the principles of them, but I always said, you know what, I'll go back and do a pre-apprenticeship. I didn't know there was such thing as a pre-apprenticeship. Yeah, I thought that was a lead to the apprenticeship, which it was.
Okay.
But I didn't lose the year. I actually gained, because that's where I got my qualification through David.
Yeah.
Because if I didn't do one, it took another route, I'd probably be in another car, vehicle, something.
Yeah, something else.
Yeah, it would be mechanic, but it'd probably be a light vehicle.
Okay.
You know, but because I was kind of halfway there, I could drive them. Like, I was driving them as a first-year apprentice. I was qualified driver.
What about the educational background? Did you finish school with Leaving Cert or Junior Cert?
I done Junior Cert, Leaving Cert.
Okay.
And I kind of went back to kind of brush on my education, which I needed to. I wasn't about, say, a couple of years out, you know.
Yeah.
And then when I done that, I passed on the exams.
All right.
You know, you would always be nervous doing exams, but when you actually pass, I'm like, yes.
Okay. Would you consider yourself like to be academic before you went down the PLC route, or was it just that you were out driving, you decided that you
Driving heavy vehicles, you'll always have to do some sort of paperwork. Okay. I always done my walk around checks. You always have pen to paper.
Okay.
Something to back you up, saying, yeah, I done my walk around, the wheels were tight, you know.
Yeah.
What are you driving, livestock, as they call passengers, or goods, either or, you know. But I'd rather have some fruit going damaged, throw them in the bin, than having a passenger saying, my head is split open, you know. You can't do that for 87 passengers, you know.
And once you got the apprenticeship, right, and you're into the interview process, what's the first day like on site or in the depot?
The first day, good question.
I'd like to hear your version. Yeah. I'll give you mine.
The first day, I don't re-torque wheels, but, okay. You know, that was my main role.
That was true.
And I found that very interesting. But right. People say, oh, I'm torquing wheels. Listen, them wheels must stay on the bus.
Yeah.
There's a specification, there's a procedure, and there's a record. You know, so we have a procedure now. When we take a wheel off, we put it on, it must go out for a test drive of 50k, come back, retorque it, and that's the procedure done.
That's it done. Okay. And that was like the first day you learned.
That's your first day. Yeah, you're torquing to 650 newton meters. That's okay. The torque spanner of it. And that's what you mainly do. You torque it to a procedure that's been recorded.
Right.
And you sign your name. But it's a first year apprentice role, which is good. And then it increases to your set of pads and your second year and your third year.
Well, Joe, you came through the apprenticeship program as well. What's your first day like? Probably a bit different.
21 years ago, Connor. Like, I'm laughing at, you know, my first day is definitely different to yours, Ahmed.
Yeah.
But no, I remember, because I suppose from being from the country, County Meath, and big into sport and GA, and then coming up to, I suppose, the city centre garage, Summerhill.
Yeah.
There was a lot of nerves. I remember the first morning walking into the bus garage. I walked straight into the middle of the, and I was told to meet the supervisor at the time, Paddy Ryan, never forget it. And on my way to find this man, Paddy Ryan, the supervisor's office, I walked by the garage manager. Sure didn't know the chain of command at the time, and I just went up to this man and I seen him. I said, sorry, do you know where Paddy Ryan is?
Right.
And he said to me, oh, his office is up there. Yeah, his office up there. I'm the garage manager, Michael Gertie. And I kind of just brushed it off and walked straight past him.
Yeah.
Like, to this day, I always remember, oh my God, I can't believe I've done that. But since I work with the same man, and he's a gentleman, we get on great. But went up to the foreman's office and, you know, basically was job with a mechanic, and give my locker and my workwear and the whole lot, and getting settled in. But the nerves that morning, I still to this day, it was one of the most nerve-wracking things I've ever done.
Yeah.
I didn't know what it was. I suppose 18 years, just turned 18, young, done leaving cert, just straight up to a mature male garage where, you know, big personalities. But I have to say, like, it was like I had gained 20 brothers just literally, as soon as I walked in, and the crack and the garage banter, and they can just put your arm around you straight away. Especially, I was from the country, in a city centre garage. I was the only country, everybody else full of dubs, like, you know. There was another guy from down my neck of the woods, and we were kind of, you know, just the two of us, but it was great. It was absolutely great. And like, to this day, I have the best of friends out of that garage, like, you know, and some of them are obviously retired, and I'm still good friends, and we go for a pint and have a chat and a catch up and talk about those times, like, you know, and like the first days, and like, I'll never forget, you know. But like that, I'm done talking of the wheels. I think my first task that I was shown was the shop run,
right? Yeah.
In the mornings, you're doing the shop run.
That's just,
it's a common thing for apprentices, you know.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Yeah. But before you got the apprenticeship, right, what was your academic background? Were you up to Leaving Cert as well, or junior?
Yeah, I done Leaving Cert, Connor. Not a great Leaving Cert, I won't lie. I suppose, like everything, I had a good junior cert, really good junior cert. And then I suppose I played a lot of sport. I was fortunate enough to play GA Gaelic football at a high level with the county at the time, from a young age all the way up to minor. And I think, like most young people at that age, thought you're going to have a career in this, and it's not a career, like, you know. It's a hobby and it's a pastime.
Yeah.
And I really enjoyed it, but I suppose maybe it took my eye off the ball a little bit with my Leaving Cert.
Okay.
And that was something that, you know, that was my own choice. But in the background, I suppose, motorsport is a huge part of my family. My dad was huge into motorsport and the rallies.
Okay.
You know, we had a lot of old Fords at home. And even going back before that, my grandfather was actually an instrument repairer in the RAF. And he was always working his own cars at home. And I'd always be there as a small boy looking at this.
Right.
Then my dad's into old Fords and going to rallies. And it kind of ingrained in me from a very young age. I loved cars. I loved that vehicles, and into that moved really.
Yeah.
Okay. From the country, you'd see tractors as well, and a lot of stuff on the road. So it was a very natural progression. So realistically speaking, I was going to go down the route of apprenticeship. Now my mother seen the advert, I remember at the time it was in the Sunday World, and said, oh, here's a Dublin Bus and Bus Éireann. Yeah. My grandfather came in and rode in behind her. Oh yeah, that's what you should apply for, I'm sure. My grandfather was a very big part of my life, and I would always listen to him, and you know, mom, dad, my granddad all kind of pushed me towards, but said, look, this is a route you go. And obviously CIE, Bus Éireann, Dublin Bus, Irish Rail, great companies to work for.
Yeah.
I know that's probably changed over the last few years. There's so many great employers now, but back then, definitely one of the top tier companies to get into.
I think any of the government organisations like Dublin Bus, CIE, or even the Defence Forces back then would have been like a job for life kind of thing.
Yeah,
you're there. 20,
oh, well, come here.
You secure your job.
It's a secure job. You know, it's a secure job. You know,
we were still working, you know, even through COVID, because passengers still, even the one at the bus stop, you had to bring the nurse into the hospital, which was good.
It's a vital service. Like, you know, even like I have a friend that works in the Lewis as well. Like, they just, the buses and public transport, that's the wrong
has to go.
Like,
has to go. Yeah.
And the way it's going now, and with the plan for like zero emissions and our targets we're setting, you know, public transport's going to be a key stakeholder in all that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, so now more than ever, there's going to be a lot of money pumped into it, infrastructure put in place to get this move in the right direction.
Yeah. Especially if they close off town as well, the traffic as well. That's on the cars now as well. Yeah.
So I might get another 21 years out. Yeah, you might. They don't come on to me. And they're not saying, what's he doing sitting doing a podcast during the day?
Start your own podcast. Brilliant. Yeah. Grand. And then once you got in, right, was there many apprenticeships or many apprentices with you on site then when you started on your first day, or was it just you?
Yeah, well, when I was in my first year, there was about four ahead of me. So each year there'd be a second year, a third year, and a fourth year.
Okay.
Probably two of each or three of each. Sometimes it depends on how many applications come in. If it's really busy, you'll take on three in 1 year.
All right. Was there any in your class? Year,
in my year, there was two. The year before me, there was three. Okay. Three apprentices ahead of me.
So you're under the wing of the second or third year?
Yeah,
first?
Okay. But you're always shadow mechanic.
Yeah.
That's where you learn, exactly.
Whether it's good or bad, you're learning from them.
If it comes back now, something wrong. What about yourself?
Things changed, Conor, the last few years. Like Ahmed's group, and I suppose group since, the numbers have increased rapidly, massively. So when I started, realistically speaking, there was probably only 20 apprentices, 10 and 10. Or maybe 15 Bus Éireann and 10 Dublin Bus. So that equates down to, for Bus Éireann side, or Dublin Bus side of the house, there was one per garage, and similar in Bus Éireann, okay? Yeah. So I would have been first year, and then there would have been one in second year, one in third year, one in fourth year. Four in total over the 4 years, okay? Done and dusted. But now we're seeing obviously with growth and expansion, we're taking on two and three per garage per year. So like this year's intake is going to be 47 between the two companies. So like it's a big number, and that then equates to, in September 2024, we'll have 168 apprentices only in HVM in the two companies. It's the biggest we've ever had. And that's just for one trade, you know? So it's huge, yeah.
Yeah, but it's good as well that you guys are able to upskill so many people as well, like all in kind of, you know, space of 4 years.
Yeah. And like we are, like our service to business person there in Ballyferm ETB, Brian Mullen, he'd often say to me, he'd say, like, you know, Dave, like, he's the biggest employer of HVM apprentices in the country, like, you know. So we're not only obviously we're looking after our own business, but there's a talent pool there nationwide. And if our apprentices don't want to stay with us, and maybe it doesn't work out over the 4 years, they are all automatically feeding back into then other companies.
Yeah.
Other industries. So we're doing kind of a service to everybody, not just to the industry, I suppose, you know.
Yeah,
it's great.
And did you find, once you started, right, was there any guys with you that started that didn't finish, whether it was in 4 second or third year, or even guys that came in underneath you that you would have helped train? Did you find many people that didn't?
No.
Everyone that's hired kind of makes it true?
Yeah, it
just depends on where, like, Ahmed might not see it, but for me, overseeing the program, I would see a few nationwide. Yeah.
Okay.
You'll have a natural fall off of maybe, if you take in a group of maybe 50 apprentices, you might lose one or two over the course of the, I mainly see it, Conor, in the first 6 months.
Okay.
The reason being is, you see in the first 6 months, due to the fact that they come in and maybe it's not what they thought it was going to be, there is a stepping stone there where you have to follow it, and they probably thought they were going to be ripping engines apart straight away and doing safety critical stuff that we can't let them at it. Like, now maybe I'm saying in other private garages and in industry, yes, you can get into that level of detail straight away and straight off the blocks, but like, we don't, because we obviously operate on the safety critical side with carrying passengers, so we can't. Yeah. So sometimes their bubble is bursting, the dreams are not what they thought they were going to be, okay? But a very small numbers.
You're kind of like going to the army and expecting to hand you a gun on day one.
I'd be devastated if I went to the army. It wouldn't last a week.
Some people don't last a day.
Yeah, I heard that.
And there'll just be a big, like, well, we had a big drop off in our class, but just a pantry. But it's interesting, not right, because I find, right, a lot of apprentices don't understand the opportunity, or guys that maybe left their apprenticeship didn't understand the opportunity they had, and then they're trying to get their apprenticeship again. That's why I asked if like, you guys see like much of a drop off.
The problem that we have here, right, at the moment in this country is there's a huge skill shortage, right? And it's craft. It's craft. So what I mean by craft is your traditional craft apprenticeships. Now we have loads of great new apprenticeships now, which I'll talk about afterwards that we're looking to get into, but the traditional craft of mechanics, plumbers, electricians, you know, bricklayers, that's a critical talent pipeline that we don't have enough people filtering into at the moment.
Yeah.
Can't build the houses that there's a shortage for, you know, can't service vehicles that we need, obviously, drivers as well to drive trucks on the road for logistics and supply chain. Like, it's crazy, massive skill shortage.
Yeah. I think we're still recovering from the last recession, right, because a lot of the trades would have moved off to Australia or whatever, and that talent didn't come back.
No. So there's a business for you.
Yeah.
Get them back. Get them back.
They're going to head to Australia if you do that.
I'm looking at it myself now, so I might get there for you. I'll go give you a hand if you want.
Yeah, why not? Yeah. You can get the one busted out.
Yeah, well, no, don't think so. No. We'll wait and see. If we get good talent, they might pay us. Yeah.
Sponsor. Yeah. Paying for. Yeah. Brilliant. Grand. And then, right, so obviously in Dublin Bus, right, going through any apprenticeship program, there's on the job and off the job training, right? So is it still seven phases that you move through as an apprentice?
Yeah, seven phases. So your phase one, you do a minimum 6 months on the job, in the garage, and then you get called to a training centre. For phase two, that's a minimum of 6 months as well.
6 months, okay.
And then you're back on the job, which is in the garage, another 6 months. Yeah. And then you do a phase four, which is a university. It's 10 weeks. That's only like 2.5 months.
Okay.
And that's actually it's not a training centre, it's a university. But the way phase two and phase four and six work, I always say the even numbers are the colleges, and the uneven is on the job.
Okay.
And another phase six is another 10 weeks. And you do university.
Yeah.
Phase seven is back on the job, and David goes through and see all your curriculum.
Make sure you signed off and everything.
Sign off.
Do you ever send someone back for further
training? Sign off. Depends if they're giving a bit of a pain. I might not sign that last line there. Yeah, leave that.
He
might go sooner. He's going, but anyway.
He put me through pressure for phase three.
Yeah.
I was pressurizing.
Yeah, he was sweating. He was sweating. Yeah, yeah.
That's what you learn.
That's what I was going to ask you then next, right? So there's obviously different ways people learn, right? So were you one that learned like from getting hands on? Were you going home looking at like YouTube videos like how to fix a wheel or were you like reading books, or like was it just, you know, once work is done you're leaving work at the door?
No, it always brought me interest. I've always interested, you know, whether it's air brakes or hydraulics.
Yeah.
I always wanted to know how does that function.
Okay.
Because it's not by me putting on a set of pads, and I don't know what pads do to the discs.
Yeah.
You know, and there's a measurement. It's interest.
Yeah. Yeah. Probably more technical than
it is technical. Yeah, and as David was saying, it's drifting a little bit, so we still have regenerative braking, which means like you're gaining energy while you're braking.
Okay.
You know, so you
this is for the hybrid engines, isn't it?
Yeah, and you always have to stay updated. You don't know everything. You know, you have to update yourself with the future, because we're turning to everything to hydrogen and fully electric vehicles.
Yeah.
I think Athlone was the first one with the fully.
Yeah, Athlone was the first. For Bus Éireann, we were very fortunate that we got the first full electric town service up and running last year in Athlone. So it was a huge milestone for Bus Éireann side of the house. Great collaboration with ESB, built a substation there to take these vehicles, because it would be a blackout if you
messed around the Athlone
full EVs, single decker. So it was great, and like
zero emissions,
and you know, we are now bringing in 34 of them into Limerick City Service.
Okay.
Double decks this time, Okay, and then with the plan, Dublin Bus side of the house then is 100 in Dublin City. Now there is hybrids running around at the moment. You'll see a lot of them at the moment. About 350, 400 of them in Dublin City.
Okay.
The same down in Galway, about 40 down in Galway, and they're moving them around as we cascade the vehicles down as we get new electric vehicles in, okay?
Yeah.
But the big thing here is we're moving at a pace now that upskilling and training of our staff is key.
Yeah.
And like, I never admit to ever being the best mechanic in the world, far from it, but you have to be willing to always take new information on. Every day is a school day. Like, I learned from the likes of Ahmed and our colleagues, I suppose, in the garages. Our garages do so much work with our apprentices. Like, I sit here and manage the program, but it's the garages that I really rely on, that they keep an eye on the team. And it's great because they let us know where there's a skills gap or need, and then we're able to help them out, help out the apprentices and help out the garage. Because at the end of the day, if the apprentices don't have adequate training, Connor, we're not doing our job as a company.
Yeah.
Like, if we don't do our job as a company, then how do we expect to run these vehicles for the people?
Mm-hmm.
And taxpayers' money is important, that we get the right service and right. And I know people give out about public transport, and like, look, it is what it is.
It's improving. We like to give
out. No, it's improving. Yes, I'm glad you said that. I'm glad you said that,
But you could be the cause of someone not getting to work early if the bus breaks down.
You're sitting, because you're sitting here with me.
Back to the workshop.
Look,
it just depends. But, well, I actually have a friend that is he's a car mechanic, then he went to work for Volkswagen and learned all about the electric cars, and now he's gone to tech support for the cars. So like, if your car breaks down or whatever, you call him and he's able to kind of find out what's going on.
It gives you so many opportunities. You wouldn't know what route you could take. It could be anything. It's a big, huge career choice that you can take.
I
never thought I'd be sitting here podcasting.
I was going to say it.
You know, I said it to my miss. She was like, "No way." I was like, "Yeah, I'll take a picture and I'll show you." Like, you're like, "You're just qualified." I was like, "I know." I never, because I used to do for David kind of open apprenticeship advertisement going to Ballyfermot Training Centre at the RDS, telling former students and school leavers or fourth year TY, saying, is it good and what do you do? And you know, I see a lot of interest in them.
Given like first hand experience.
That's important. That's important for us to try and get the likes of Ahmed and our apprentices out there, because they sell it better than I do. Like, and come here, I went through it. But when you get older, young people don't look at it, they're like, oh, what's he on about? He hasn't got a clue. And I wouldn't have thought that I'd be sitting here 21 years later doing this. But I rely on Ahmed and our apprentices to sell it and spread the word. It's as much about social, I know social media is a huge puller for us, but it's also word of mouth still, where you have the apprentices on the floor talking about it. And former apprentices like Ahmed come along and doing this, you know. It's key. It is key.
No, it definitely is. Have you trained? Do you have any or many apprentices under your wing at the moment to train and bring them on?
I actually, when I first day as a qualified mechanic, I was given an apprentice. A fourth year apprentice. Which is not far off. He only has one more phase to do. So I trust him because I know he knows. You know, do a set of pads. He has to say, look, assisted Ahmed, but it's my paperwork. I say, please, before you put the wheel, I want to sleep at night. I want to check it out, you know. And we have to always brake test a vehicle. It's a transportation. It's carrying passengers. But just alone in my garage, there's 9 apprentices. You know. And the apprenticeship program is open now for David in March, so that's going to probably take on another.
We have the 47. So close is actually, we'll close it and wrap it up the 19th of March this year. We've extended it out, so it's usually, sorry, the 19th of April. The start of March, it used to run for the month of March, but we've extended it out a little bit this year and last year to try and capture as many people as possible to the 19th of April. And then we'll close up and start getting aptitude tests out and the whole lot and get it up and running. But you know, look, I suppose like everything, it's a race for talent now at the moment, Connor.
It's mad.
Like, you know, and like in fairness, you know, right from the top down, from our SLT, from our CEOs in both companies, like Stephen Kent or Billy Han, they promote it from the top down, and they're about apprenticeship, and you know, I that's great. So it's an easy sell for us when we have that push down to our SLT, to our head of engineering and our engineering function. Like, you know, they're great support to us, and they'll push it and promote it, and that's they'll help us as best we can, you know. And because at the end of the day, as I said to you, if we don't have these apprentices coming through and filtering into the roles, like, they don't just stay as apprentices, they qualify, they're craft worker, mechanics, and then they can move into other areas. So like, it's not just the I suppose the running and maintenance of vehicles. Yeah. It could go anywhere. They could go driving. They could do, you know, into managerial supervisor roles.
That is the golden ticket, the level 6 QQI. Mm. You're going to need that as an entry to do a level 7, a level 8, any engineering out there.
All the mechanics have to become Arctic drivers or bus drivers. Do they work through their different licenses?
So there's a slight little difference there between the two companies, and we just actually touched on that earlier on, myself and yourself outside. So in the Bus Éireann side of the house, once you hit 21, you can get your D license, which is bus. In the Dublin Bus side of the house, the same for the bus, but you also get your C&E, you get your Arctic and Rigid. So a slight difference there. The reason being for that, Dublin Bus have tow trucks. You see the bus player running around the place. They're not getting much work now. But they come along and they tow their buses back. And once you hook up that tow bar, that becomes an articulated vehicle. With the Bus Éireann side of the house, what we do then on that side of the house is we have a contractor that comes in, and if we cannot get that vehicle back up and running through our breakdown van, they come in and they lift the vehicle and they drag it home for us. I suppose, like everything, there was risk assessments and safety protocol put in place, and it was reviewed by one company to say, okay, we'll go this route. Dunbar said to go that route. So it just depends.
It depends on what
company you get into. Now, like that being said, there are so many training courses out there now that you can get your original Arctic in your own time if you want as well. And we'll support that now in Bus Éireann. There is study support schemes in place. So if you're going to look at that, then we mightn't do it internally, but we will support you externally if you need a bit of time off or this, that, and the other to do that, you know.
And why not? So are you doing CPCs then as well?
You don't have to do all the case studies. I think you're...
No, because they're for actual
professional drivers.
Paid passengers.
So it's just certain CPCs.
Yeah, certain CPCs will get you across.
But the multiple choice, theory questions, yeah.
Yeah. You have your Arctic rigid or rigid.
Yeah, I got the rigid for the army. Yeah, so I was lucky enough. But got out.
Thanks.
It was a good fallback, right? So if anything else failed or all else failed, I still had those licenses, right?
Yeah.
So
it's good. That is a qualification in its own.
Well, we recruit truck drivers, you know, and some truck drivers make $50,000 a year, you know. There's some good paying
truck driving jobs out there.
Probably some guys making more. Those companies probably paying enough. They don't need to come near the agencies.
Well, that's it.
Once you've got like through your training and everything else, right? What's the day to day like now that you're fully qualified?
Well, the way Bus Éireann garage I'm based in, you get an inspection sheet.
Okay.
And you have to inspect the bus.
Yeah.
From inside to interior, exterior. Make sure that it's safe enough to go back out on the road.
Yeah.
And because you need a license to drive the bus, so they will actually support you to get a license, so you take it out on the road.
You take it for a test drive.
Is this safe enough to be in? It comes back in 100%, you send it out.
Okay. Is there like servicing that has to be done on the buses every couple of weeks or every couple of months? Or do you just fix them and they're broke?
No.
Preventative maintenance.
No, there's different. So a bus can come back in 2 weeks, inspect that.
Yeah.
You know, there's kind of, they do an A, B or a C doc. So if it's a C doc, do a brake test.
Okay.
Quick inspection, safe, send it on. Okay. Check the lights, interior, exterior, everything, trip hazards inside.
Right. And during the apprenticeship then as well, right? So were you moving around to different locations, or were you just in the one garage for the whole
apprenticeship? No, I was based in one, but you can. I was. I was, you know, delighted that I was kept.
That would be mainly for the regional operation of the Bus Éireann piece. Some of our garages might just specifically work on school transport, so that there'd be one type of vehicle. So at the moment we're looking at, with a colleague of mine, in his region, he'd be over, say, a set region, maybe. I'll give you an example, Limerick, Turles, Tralee.
Yeah.
He's on about possibly interchanging a few of the apprentices around the depots to get experience in different vehicle types.
Okay.
That's just because of the technology that's moving into our garages. Okay. So the school's garages may or may not get that technology for a while. And he's kind of forecasting and foreseeing maybe, right, let's get these apprentices into a garage that has the modern stuff to give them the same experience every week, which is great. Yeah. So
everyone's being brought up to speed.
And that's something that we're looking to go at this year. Like, I suppose in years gone by, it hasn't been done necessarily because the technology hasn't advanced as much as it is now. Okay. Like, the future, we're always saying it's down the road, it's here now.
Yeah,
it's not the future, it's here. Like, so, yeah. Okay. So we're now looking to do that, which is a new thing for us. There'll be probably a few apprentices that live 5 minutes down the road from the garage, say, I don't want to go here, that's an hour's drive. But for their career, I think they'll see the benefit, you know.
And then getting to and from work, right? So you're obviously, you could drive at that time. Did you have a car or were you driving to work?
I had a car, I actually always looked at the weather.
Right.
It's pissing now, I'm not stopping at that bus stop. Yeah, but if it's nice and the day are longer and I get the bus, headphones in and...
What are you? Are you driving?
Free travel.
Free travel.
Great.
That's
one of our benefits.
Country
boy. I got up on the bus or the train.
When I started
originally, Connor, I had a license. I had my. Okay. I was driving my dad's van at the time, one of his work vans, and I was, you know, big into motorsport, and I was kind of going down the route getting my license anyway. But when I came in, then all of a sudden I was fast tracking to get my full car license, which was great.
Right. Yes.
Super. But Internal Credit Union bought my first car out of happy days. But I drove it to the bus stop or the train, and I would park my car there in the car park, and I would hop on the bus or train up to Dublin. Traffic some mornings great. If you got the 6 o'clock, you get up before 7, it was great.
Yeah.
But like everything, if it was a crash in the road, you're in trouble. Yeah. But that was the hard yards in those first few years because the money was small.
Mm-hmm.
So I couldn't afford to drive my car up and down to Dublin.
And
we have the free, so basically you get a privileged ticket identity card where you can hop on buses and trains. Once you're part of the CIE group, and you can utilize it for work,
okay.
So it's great.
So
I used it until, like, realistically speaking, I used it right up until I started getting promoted when I was on shift. I was on shift work, I drove in because of just the hours that you worked, and it was great. You fly home in 45 minutes, but that was a huge benefit. It's a huge benefit,
And I suppose, what time are you starting work at? Like, what are your working hours?
When
you started your apprenticeship, right? Because some guys, right, I hate going to school, and it's because they hate getting out of bed at 8 o'clock in the morning.
They're in trouble.
At 9. But then, you know, you get an apprenticeship and you have to get up at 5 to make it to 1:40.
Yeah.
Or 7. No,
we choice.
Start at 7.
Yeah, there you go.
7 to half 3.
Yeah.
7 to half 3.
Yeah.
And
it was in the morning when I was doing my apprenticeship that I think the latest I'd get up at 6 to get to make sure I got that bus to get in for. I used to start at 8 o'clock in Summerhill. So like there was a travel and a commute there that you had to account for. You had to account for. Unfortunately the hard yards have to be done, and I'm very lucky that it worked out well for me, and I love my job. It's a great place to work, but those first few years you have to sacrifice, make the sacrifices. Mm-hmm. Like getting into work, I do say to anybody starting off an induction when we do it with them, the hardest part is getting yourself in there. When you get in there, everything else is there for you to make it work for you. The staff are great, the equipment is there, it's up to you to take it and to go with it. If you get in and get yourself there and you have a good attitude, you're laughing, you're halfway there. Like, and as I said to you, I never ever would admit to ever being the best mechanic, but I had a good attitude where I got myself in and enjoyed the work environment.
I think that's half the battle, it's just getting lads to the office or to work, you know.
Apparently
it's just showing up, you know. Well, 80% of the job is probably just showing up, you know, and then
being
willing to learn and take advice.
Exactly. I'd agree, totally.
Yeah, great. Grant, what about then? You didn't have to do a shop run, did you, when you first started?
There wasn't really many shop runs, no. Just go and shadow a mechanic, and you know, because we have a facility, a canteen.
Okay, so canteen.
They're
spoiled.
The main depot.
You had a shop run back then.
I had a shop run, I used to come out of Summerhill Garage and head on to Gardner Street there and get the... I shouldn't put it in, but Central in the corner, free plug from there. They get the old breakfast rolls and stuff in the morning. But I'd always try and leave it. I was a cute country lad. I'd always try and leave a few bob in it for myself at the end. Maybe cover my own roll out of their lunch money. But come here. It was one of those things. Yeah. You learn the value of, I suppose, respect of your colleagues and also of money at that stage, because, you know, first years are still on €230 a week, roughly, give or take.
Okay.
Back then, I was probably on 100 quid, depending, give or take. It's small money, so you learn to appreciate that and to respect for money. I think it's a real solid grounding. Nowadays, I suppose, sometimes apprentices come in and they feel that they should be on bigger money, but I think you need to have those little stepping stones, do your shop run, be on the small money,
yeah.
hard yards, travelling in a bus or a train.
Yeah,
no, it's
and
important.
Appreciate it, right?
Big time.
Because, yeah, look, a lot of guys with, well, look, some people, not everybody, would look and say, well, why would I go to work for €230 a week when I can sit at home for 180? That's the drawback.
Sitting at home, you're not getting a
You're not learning anything. I find it's an investment in time,
yeah,
and you're
yeah.
still learning. Like,
you always have to start in the small step.
Yeah, and you're being paid to
yeah.
learn, right? So
yeah.
you have to go to college, you know.
Yeah, and you still get paid to learn.
You're slaving away
in college.
Yeah. We pay for your college fees and other stuff.
Yeah.
Look here.
Yeah,
so if you go to your 4 and 6, which is in the TUS or TUD, we pay for that €1,000 college fee. So that's all
covered.
You know, and we buy our apprentices their toolkits now.
Yeah.
So I think Ahmed, you had to actually reimburse at the time.
Yeah.
But now we've changed in the last 2 years where we basically take the full cost of that kit.
Okay.
And you don't give us anything back. It's yours, it's paid for. Now if you left after 6 weeks, we obviously keep the kit, take it off you. But like if you're there, that's yours, pay for the fees, provide all your workwear. You know, so like there's loads of incentives there for students to basically get involved in, but it's up to them to take it, you know.
Yeah, you have to kind of accept it with both hands as well.
Yeah,
you
do.
Bring a horse to war, you can't make him drink.
Great saying, love it.
And what's the promotional aspects then once you're qualified, right? So obviously you're the apprenticeship coordinator now, and like how long were you qualified before you kind of moved?
I suppose, give or take, my kind of career path to date, I done my 4 years and then spent about 6 years then in the garage then as a qualified mechanic craft worker, and then but I also covered lead hand. So lead hand is basically stepping in for the supervisor when they're on leave, whether they're on holidays or whatever. So that might be shift work or whatever it may be, days. And I suppose the key there was to put your best foot forward, get on with people. You're dealing with drivers and also the maintenance side of the house, so that was key there. So I would, anybody that has kind of the grow to get on in this in the area would be putting their hand up to try and get onto that panel, you know, for that. So that kind of put me a little bit in the spotlight. Went for a few interviews, chanced my arm on a couple, won't lie.
Yeah.
You know, I like to pride myself in doing that because I get on. I like to think that I am good with talking, obviously, as you can hear, and with people. So that was kind of one of the key. Somebody said to me at the time in the garage, why don't you go for an interview there to see how you get on? I went for the interview, and it went well. Now I was nervous, but it went well, and that kind of set the tone because the person that interviewed me at the time rang back to say, look, you've done well. You didn't get the job, but you've done well.
Okay.
You know, encourage him and push him in the right direction. Fortunate enough then, I got promoted then into the health and safety department in O'Connor Street for Dublin Bus as the safety auditor for the company. That was a great move for me because the company were basically willing to send me back to college to do a health and safety degree. To further myself and also to underpin the role to make sure you have your education to back it up. So going around the garages, and I suppose I was going around the garages auditing my colleagues, which was hard because then you were kind of one of the lads on the floor one day, and the next then you're obviously checking them. So the target on my back.
David's coming down.
But that was the kind of thing, like people that I got on with for years kind of were like, oh geez, here he is. But still it was great, like, you know. And that was at a supervisor level as such, and the next natural step for me was to try and get into the managerial role, which came up 8 years ago roughly. The current role I am is apprenticeship program manager, and I was fortunate enough to go for the interview, done well, went for a second interview with the chief mechanical engineer at the time and the senior manager of the technical department. And as I said, my colleague Suzanne McGilloway, who actually interviewed me in my first interview for apprenticeship. So fortunate enough to get that, and I'm here ever since. And like everything, Connor, I'm delighted because I feel like I've come full circle with it.
Yeah,
you know, so
it's the tenure, I suppose. I know my background, the defence force, like people who stay there like the whole 21 years, is the 10 year the same at Dublin Bus, or would people leave, you know, before the pension?
Well, it depends. Like in years gone by, everybody would stay, and it was a job for life, and that was, as we said earlier on, people seen that as, right, okay, you're in happy days, and then you can move through the different roles if you wanted to get promoted.
Yeah.
The company will support you, study support schemes, the whole lot. But then people then also want to stay driving and then stay in the garage working on the tools, which is great. Okay. Nowadays we're seeing a very different landscape, as you know yourself.
Yeah.
People are willing to take a chance and jump and go to another company for £100 extra. don't see the pension as being a major thing anymore.
No.
And like I used to laugh, I didn't see it until I hit 30 and was looking at getting married and having children. And all of a sudden now, being 38, I'm like, whoo, that's great. Important.
It's important.
But I think trying to sell that to people now is a harder sell nowadays because they don't see it. It's short. We do feel and we do see that people come in to train with us and then they're gone after a couple of years. So that is like, it's a revolving door such, okay? But to try and get this to stick with people when they're here with us is the most important thing now, you know?
Okay.
Yeah, because it is a job for like, I am very happy and I love my job to bits and it's created a great foundation for my family and my wife and my children.
Yeah.
So I'm very, very, you know, I'm so delighted with that and, you know, so thankful to the two companies for giving me that opportunity. So while yes, you won't be a millionaire, you have a very good life, you know. Yeah, and there's flexibility there as well, which is great, you know.
Just one more thing I want to go back to. You know, you mentioned shift work there. Mm. You're saying you worked 7:30 to 3:30. Is there shift work then for the apprentices, or not for the apprentices, but in the garage?
Yeah,
is there shift work?
They shift mechanics.
Okay.
Or late shift mechanics, which is like.
Okay. Does it rotate?
We have a 2 or 3 cycle.
Okay.
You know, so.
And weekends as well?
Weekends, yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Very good. Extra few bob, you know, going in on the Sunday.
Hey,
on the double.
Double?
Yeah. You know.
Don't give away too many tickets in that one. We could be in trouble.
Yeah, when you do qualify, as Dave was saying, it could lead to many opportunities.
Okay.
You won't get rich.
Yeah.
But it'll pay the bills.
Yeah.
That's what we're here for.
Are apprentices in on a set schedule or are they shift as well?
Well, you see, depending on location, I suppose you can, it's mainly Monday to Friday, 8:30, 4:00, 7:30, 3:00, depending on local agreement, okay? But now we have brought in some locations around the country where you can actually go on shift. So you can basically shadow the mechanic at all times once the mechanic is in on shift.
Yeah.
So that we have left that flexibility there in their contracts that if it suits them, work away. Because like, why wouldn't you? Like, you know, it's an option for them to kind of get experience on shift as well and see what it's about.
And is there a shift allowance for an apprentice or is it just set salary scale? Because there would be a way of increasing.
Yes, there is a, now it just depends on the location and the local agreement,
okay?
Technically, by right, you know, you're supposed to be on your apprentice wage,
set wage,
okay? You know, and then the shift mechanic would get the shift allowance as such,
which is
fair enough. But if we're doing it that way with the apprentices and that they're coming in and they're happy to do that, then they're just on their normal flat.
Okay.
You know, once it's not looping into the weekend. If it's looping into the weekend, then obviously overtime or different rates apply.
Okay.
That's the way which would be fair.
Weekend. Still an investment then, with
It is, yeah.
You have
it is.
To put that investment into yourself as well. Right? So
I think it's important because then to get a full, I think what we've been guilty of over the years is sometimes we don't get a full view of the business.
Yeah.
And shift work definitely gives people a full view of what goes on, not just your 8 to 4.
Yeah.
It gives you a full view. Okay, this is 24 hours.
Happens.
Yeah. It's important.
Yeah.
It's important. Yeah.
Yeah. No, definitely. And look, anyone that's going into an apprenticeship now, what advice would you give them, having just qualified a couple of months back?
You don't need any experience to get into this.
Right.
To be honest, no background, you just interest.
Just have an interest.
Yeah, and sticking to it. Next thing, you're learning every day. Every day is a school day, you know, because you've no habits. You
just
don't go and tell them, oh, I do it this way or I do it that way. It's, you know, mechanics are always around you. If you don't know the answer, someone know the answer.
What about you? Any advice for someone going in?
Yeah, I think we touched on it earlier on. Like the key, I suppose, is to just be a blank canvas and let everything just go on to it. Because you know, every day is a school day. I'm learning every day, and you know, attitude, outlook, and just get in on time. That's important. You know, being on time, Connor, and like, you know, that shows to us then that you're willing to.
You're interested.
Like, there's no such thing then as a stupid question. Get the questions, ask the questions.
Yeah.
You know
it's
from the garage.
Teamwork.
Yeah.
Everyone learns off each other.
And enjoy it. Enjoy it.
You want someone to look forward to going to work as well. Like, that's what's going to help you get out of bed and then.
Yeah, well, like,
rainy mornings.
I enjoy, I love my job, as I said, and I think you know that already.
Yeah.
And I really enjoy it, like, because it's like, if you find something that you love, it's an everyday's work.
Yeah.
And that's a key. And I know people say that the whole time. I was like, oh, look, here he's going with this line. But the fact of the matter is, if that's the case, then it's great. You know, happy days. And you avoid the things that kills, I suppose, a company is the absenteeism and people turning late.
Yeah.
Like, that's not what you want. So no matter whether you come into the likes of a Bus Éireann or Dublin Bus background, I'd strongly encourage anybody that's listening in, like, to get a job that suits them, because that way then that's you making the decision.
Exactly, yeah. So different people will want to work different shifts. Mm-hmm. Some people want Monday to Friday. Not everybody wants to be an entrepreneur.
No.
You know, so there's routes for everyone, right? And there's jobs for everybody. Yeah. Even if it's not the one, we'll sit with someone else. But yeah, it's important to know what you want and then go after it.
Yeah,
exactly.
You guys are also on the lookout for qualified mechanics as well, is that right?
Absolutely. Qualified mechanics, drivers, engineers, you name it, we want them. But we are looking at mechanics at the moment in both companies, and that's a huge piece we're looking for, to try and fill in our garage staff and keep the vehicles on the road, and you know, expand drivers as well, and mechanical engineers, obviously, for obvious reasons, driving vehicles, and then also then doing the background work on vehicle specs. So engineers are required for that. But it's all basically at the moment, Connor, any jobs that are going are at the careers@busairn.ie or the Dublin Bus website, and there's a tile on the Dublin Bus website with the careers as well, and it's basically all there. And you know, application process, we all have to apply for jobs, and unfortunately it can take a little bit of work, but I'd hope that it is worthwhile at the end.
Yeah, definitely. Just real quick, right, so if let's say someone was doing a second year apprenticeship, right, they're on the second year apprenticeship with another HGV company, can they apply as well?
So actually only yesterday I transferred a guy from another company there. He's a fourth year apprentice, which is great, and we took that's two in the past couple of weeks, so nearly out of time. They've transferred of employer, which is a transfer employer form through Solus, and we've processed them and they've come into us, which is great. So that's a real scoop for us. We're delighted with getting them. And one guy was actually with us previously and went to try the outside, and now he's come back. So it's great. It's great.
So no stick for him.
Look at the career, he's more than capable of taking it, so it's grand. But we're open to that, because like realistically speaking, we have done a new pay deal there recently, so we're very competitive on the wages for qualified staff when they come out of their apprenticeship. It was quite competitive. So on that front then, I think it's definitely worthwhile people looking into it if you're second, third or fourth year, you know.
Are you fast tracked if you're like second, third or fourth year?
Fast tracked into
Dublin Bus if you
you don't have to apply through the normal process of a first year apprentice. So basically if your CV comes into us through the HR department, then technically you're actually skipping all the phase one stuff where you have to do application aptitude test, all that. That's kind of nearly done and dusted. It's more just a local interview with us then to see, you know, where you'll fit in and if you'll fit in. You've skipped, but you still have to do pre-employment, medical, all that crap. That all has to follow on. But the fact that you're already in the system as such as a HVM, you have a lot of that groundwork done, so then it's going to be a local interview that we'll go with there. It won't be the normal recruitment drive.
And I know you mentioned drug testing at the start, right? Is drug testing just at the start of the career, or is, I know we're in the army, it's random?
Random now as well, so public transport's gone all that way. Alcohol drug testing is random now as well, same.
If you don't show up every Monday and Friday, you're
you're
come here, this looks as good as you are. Come here, medical.
Yeah.
And it's even alcohol, anything, you know.
Showing up intoxicated onto the
That's the thing,
it's a serious job at the end of the day, right? How many passengers is the bus playing?
Well, it max up to 87, some of the triaxles there, but that becomes a wrecking ball. If that goes out of control, like, never mind there's 87 in the vehicle behind you. Like,
not alone.
So, like, and look, I know things change over years and that, but, like, the safety critical element of this, you have to be tested. Like, you know, for years gone by, it was just a direct interview, I suppose, and then you'd done a pre-employment medical. That was it, done and dusted. It was gone. Cool. Now the random, like, if you're having absenteeism Mondays and Fridays, then we could send you for a medical. That was fine. But now it's random. So say here, just before Christmas, our department, they landed in Broadstone, and they just done a random call off the roll, off the employee register, to see who was around, pulled them all in, and that was it, you know. Okay. So like, it's there, and it's there for a reason.
Thanks very much for coming in.
Appreciate
it. You happy enough?
Is anything else? Come here. No, it's great. But just check us out at careers@busairn.ie for a current recruitment campaign, and dublinbus.ie as well. As I said to you, we're live till the 19th of April. Spread the word about apprenticeship. If you know of anyone who wants to be a mechanic, pull us up. And sure, we might link in again. You might bring me on a recruitment drive somewhere abroad as a consultant. Or we might work with you.
We work with some public sector organisations, so
very good.
You never know. Well, yeah, look, thanks very much, guys.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks, Dan. Appreciate it.